Namaste everyone, this is Dr. Aisha Bhutalia. I welcome you all for today's session on the basic concepts of rough sex. In our previous lecture, we tried to connect the importance of rough sex theory as a framework for data mining and machine learning. And we had initiated with its definition of the information and the decision system, which we refer to as the tables. Then we had also discussed about the indiscernibility relations, where we had discussed about the equivalence classes, how to calculate them on each and every attribute, the parts of the information system. Then we had discussed about the set approximation, that is lower approximation, upper approximation, boundary, positive region, negative region. Today we are going to discuss about the rest of the topics which was declared in our previous lecture, that is reduction core, rough membership, dependency of attributes, decision rules, and so on. Basically, this redux is going to be very, very useful for feature reduction technique. This is an algorithm which is a base of rough set theory used as a technique for feature selection, feature reduction, as discussed earlier. That one of my examples in a paper about the mushroom plant, where we had 16 attributes and we tried to reduce it to 3 attributes so that our classification becomes more simple and rather more accurate to reduce the complexity. And we can convert it from data information algorithm knowledge to the intelligence. So the highlight would be redux for this purpose of lecture. So let's continue. Last time, as discussed, the information table consists of 4 parts. U is the objects, finite set of objects. V is the domain value of each attribute. Q, where the all the attributes define the capital set Q, containing of all the attributes of that particular decision table. The V is the specific domain for that particular attribute, and F is the decision function. We had seen the example of the car database, where the condition attributes, engine, size, color, depending upon that, we can have a decision attribute whether the car is good or bad. So this is the classification. You can categorized even rough set theory can be used for classification and clustering as well as we go on. Then we had discussed about the indiscernibility relation, and where we try to convert the equivalence classes, okay, denoted at capital X1, X2. These are the equivalence classes are nothing but the clusters, you can say, of the similar objects. You have to decide on which decision attribute or condition attribute you need to categorize the sets. So cluster is nothing but a set. And a set of a same family termed as equivalent classes is capital X. So you can have n number of equivalence classes. For example, in our previous case, you can have equivalence classes on engine, on size, on color, on the combination of engine size. So 2 to the power n minus 1 equivalence classes can be defined. So to calculate the disassembly objects are the equivalence classes. Okay, this is the smallest group of objects, which is also known as A basic knowledge. Okay, so A can be a single attribute also. When we combine all the attributes, then it is called as the indiscernibility relation. So disassembly we can calculate on each attribute, and when we combine all of them, then it is denoted by IND of A. So that is why it is union of, okay, all the combinations. So considering the attribute A as engine, we calculate the A eliminatory sets, and we said that A eliminatory sets are nothing but the A basic knowledge called as the DAS, discernible blocks. So we have one set for propane, we have one set for gasoline, and one set for diesel, because if you can see, the domain values are 3 values propane, diesel and gasoline. So since the domain values are 3, there will be 3 equivalent classes. So if a question arises, how many equivalence classes can be there on a single attribute, then depending upon, say, if there are n number of domain values for the attribute A, then there will be n number of equivalence classes related to A. Okay, so if there are 3 attributes and each having different type of domain values, then suppose this has n domain values, this has m and this is z. So this will be n into number of attributes. Okay, so m, n and z into 3. Those many number of equivalence classes you will be having for that particular data set or the information table or the decision table, right? So this we had discussed in our previous lecture, and then coming to the set approximation, we had identified the lower approximation set called as the positive region, the boundary region, which is upper approximation minus lower approximation, and the negative region is the entire number of objects minus the lower approximation. Okay, in simple terms, you can identify that the lower approximation where you have exact answer, okay, definite answer. So if you can save the lower approximation of equivalence class X1, and X1 is related to propane, right? So you will have X1, okay, because there is no ambiguity related to X1. So where there is a definite answer, that is called a lower approximation. Upper approximation where there is ambiguity. So if you can see here, the ambiguity is related to gasoline, because in certain examples, the answer is good. In certain examples, the answer is bad. Okay. So this will be the upper approximation set. So that's why you have X1, X5, X6, X7 and X8. Why X1 is there? Because the good is also good year, and the concept here is totally on the decision that is good. So when the matter of good car is concerned, obviously X will also be included in the upper approximation. And as we said earlier, that upper approximation, lower approximation will always be the subset of the upper approximation. Okay, so your upper approximation is X1 related to propane. The lower approximation, the upper approximation is X5, X6, X7, X8. So union will be X1, X5, X6, X7 and X8. Okay, so as related to our formula, boundary is calculated and the boundary is X5, X7, 6, X7, X8. Because this is the ambiguity which is. So X1 got discarded because there was no ambiguity. Okay, so the boundary needs to be handled using our rough set theory. And that is why, since the boundary of X is not 0, that is why this data set is rough. Okay, and what exactly is rough will be the data members of the boundary region, whereas the other members are crisp. Now, since this classification was on the decision is equal to good, that is why the negative region, the attributes related to diesel will come, because the decision is opposite to good, that is bad. Okay, so that is why the negative region will be X2, X3 and X4. So seen in terms of diagram, this is the lower approximation, this is the boundary region, and the boundary region is yes or no. That's why we are calling that as an uncertainty in the data. That's why it is called rough set, rough, because in our previous lecture, we said that rough set theory is very powerful mathematical tool to handle uncertainty. So wherever there is a yes, no type of uncertainty, we call it as rough. And then this is the negative region. Why? Because the decision was an S, so opposite is no. So this will be the negative region. This is lower approximation or the positive region. This one. Okay. So this also we had discussed in our previous lecture. Now coming to the dispensable and the indispensable attributes. Now what is dispensable? Dispensable means which has to be disposed. That is not important, right? Or which is redundant rather. And indispensable are the important attributes which you need to retain. And based on the indispensable attribute, you can have a good decision-making algorithm. So let's see if A, it belongs to, small a is a subset, you know, of the capital A. okay, where A is the attribute of that information table or the system. So attribute A is dispensable in that table T, okay. For example, the mushroom data set, which I explained last time, if there are 16 attributes, so we try to find out the three indispensable attributes. So rest of the 13 attributes were dispensable. Now, how to calculate that? Through the mathematical term using the Repsit theory that we are seeing here. So if attribute A is dispensable in T, if, okay, this is positive region of A with respect to B, is equal to, if this condition is true, that positive region of A with respect to B is equal to positive region of A minus A. Now this is a single attribute, whereas A is the entire set of attributes. Okay, so positive region of this subset of B is true. Okay, otherwise attribute A is indispensable in T. That means if this is true, okay, then we say that it is a dispensable attribute. So if this is not true, then we say that it is an indispensable attribute and we need to retain it. Now, how to calculate this positive region? Let's see. The A positive region of B. Okay, so A positive region of B. This is termed like that. Okay, it is the union of all the lower approximations. Okay, of the X belongs to B star. Now, X is all the equivalence classes as termed earlier. X1, X2, capital X are the equivalence classes. And what is B star? B star is all the indispensable, indisciplinary relations. Okay. So, indisciplinary relations, as I told you, that if we take equivalence classes DES of A, A is a single attribute. But if we take all the attributes of the table, then that relation is called as indisciplinary relation. If you see earlier, if you remember, over here, see, first we calculated the equivalence class for every attribute. Okay, this is equivalence classes. This is related to propane, this is related to diesel, and this is related to gasoline, right? This X3 is related to gasoline. Now, what is indisciplinary relation? It is the union of all the equivalence classes. Now, since this was termed equivalence classes for only engine, this IND is also for engine only. So we first calculate the equivalence classes and then we do the union, and that is called the indisciplinary relation. So coming further, so B star is this. Or you can also say that A positive region of B is nothing but the lower approximation divided by the each and every indisciplinary relation. Okay, now lower approximation on A and indisciplinary relation on B. This should be noted. Okay, here there should be no confusion. Then you can directly calculate using this mathematical formula. Lower approximation of A. If we are calculating the A positive region of B, then we need to consider the lower approximation of A. Okay. And indisciplinary relation we need to consider in terms of B. Let's see with an example. Okay, this will be more clear to you. So just to summarize, okay, T is consisting of U, A, and B is independent if all A belonging to capital A, that is a subset attribute A, to the entire set of attributes are indispensable in T. Okay, so this relation becomes indispensable when all the attributes are indispensable, right? So we need to identify each and every attribute, and those which are dispensable, we need to remove it from the data set. So basically, whatever is this, now this set A after the reduction, okay, that means the set, the elements all which are in the set A, which are indispensable, that is called as reduct. So keep only those attributes that preserve the indisciplinary relation and consequently set approximation. So those are called as redux. So now you can understand redux contains all the elements that are satisfying the indisciplinary relation. That means every attribute is indispensable, is important. That means without that attribute, you cannot take the decision. Sometimes there are attributes which are superfluous. Okay, that means they are extraneous. We can also call dispensable attributes as extraneous attributes. So extraneous attributes, okay, no doubt, you can keep it. It will not harm your decisions, but it will unnecessarily increase the complexity of your data set. So there are usually several such subsets of attributes, and those which are minimal are called redux. So there can be n number of attributes that can be uniquely combined to form an indisciplinary relation. Example, if there are a table mushroom had 16 attributes. Okay, so we could have say four sets which uniquely identified the mushroom plant, whether it is edible or poisonous, right? 16 attributes identified that it, classifying that it is edible or poisonous, but we tried to reduce it to three. But actually, when we had calculated the equivalence classes, there were three sets which uniquely defined. In one set, there were four attributes. In another set, there were five attributes. And in another set, there were three attributes. So which will be the redux? The redux would be the set which was having three attributes. That means there can be multiple sets which uniquely defined, which, you know, having satisfying the indisciplinary relation. But redux is something which is having the minimal attributes. Because why you will consider the set with five attributes when it can be done with the other combination of three attributes, right? Okay, so just to summarize and avoid confusion, whatever we said, that there were three subsets which uniquely classified, for example, one with five attributes, one with four attributes, and one with three attributes. Okay, so all these three will be called as redux. And the minimal because why they are called redux? Because they are the minimum attributes which uniquely classify that particular decision problem. Okay, so these are called redux. But the out of the three, for example, there may be n redux. So out of the n redux, okay, which is the minimum redux, okay, that we call it as a core. So if removing of attribute introduces inconsistency, then the attribute is used as a core. Else it is not used as a core. That means if we remove that attribute, okay, and our data is not consistent as earlier, that means that attribute is very, very important for our decision problem. Okay, so we include that attribute in the core. Okay, so how we calculate the core? Every attribute we try to reach from our attribute set, okay, and calculate the positive region of that attribute with respect to B. Okay, now B is what? B is basically for which you are finding the dependency, correct? So if that is equal to this subset positive region, if this is equal to possible, then we include that attribute A in that core. If it is not equal, because just we said earlier that if it is equal to, then it is a dispensable attribute. Okay, and if it is not equal to, then we say that it is a indispensable attribute. So if it is not equal to, then it is a it is very, very important for maintaining consistency. You cannot remove that particular attribute, right? So where core of B of A is the set of all the dispensable attributes in the set A. So all redux, that is family of redux of A, are denoted by RED. F is the family and of A. That is, they can be many minimal sets. As just now we said, there were three sets, one with five attributes, one with four, one with three. Okay, and what is the core? Core is basically the subset. Okay, the subset of, or you can say the intersection of all the redux. So we'll see with an example, it will be more clear. So there is a U of the system, that is number of objects. Then this is headache, one conditional attribute, muscle pain, another, and temperature, another. Now depending upon what is the headache, if the person has headache, if the person has muscle pain, if the person has temperature, we will decide whether the person is having flu or not. Okay, so here we can say that if headache is there, if the person has muscle pain, but if the temperature is normal, then that is not a case of flu. Whereas if all the three conditions are true, then we can term that there is a flu, right? So if yes, yes. So this is yes, yes here. Okay, these all three are yes, yes. U1, U2, U3. Headache and muscle is yes, yes, but temperature is different. Okay, temperature is different. So the decision value of flu is also different. Okay, so how to calculate the reduct? So there is one reduct on muscle pain and temperature. So if we consider that muscle pain and temperature are, see, there you can calculate reducts as condition attribute. There are n condition attributes. So 2 to the power n minus 1 combinations you can take. So one combination is muscle pain and temperature. Then you calculate, see, U1 and U4. U1 and U4. Why we considered U1 and U4? Because the muscle pain is yes in both the cases. Whereas the temperature is also normal in both the cases. So we termed as one row in this particular category. Then U2 is another classification where the muscle pain is yes, but the temperature is high. The flu is yes. Then U3, U6 is again the same. So to reduce the redundancy, we have combined it into one column where this is yes and this is very high. This is no and this is high. So you can see the four permutation combinations with different values of both. Okay, as a set. So the another reduct can be the combination of headache and temperature. So similarly, you can calculate these two reducts. Okay, you can term this as reduct 2 over here in this case. So there can be n number of reducts. So you have to calculate the disability matrix that is relative to the positive region. So how to calculate the reducts? First, you need to decide the n disability matrix. Okay, that's the prerequisite. So let's see that. By a disability matrix of X denoted by M of T. If you remember in our previous lecture, see, there are issues in the decision table that some of the attributes may be superfluous, that is redundant. So ultimately, we are now discussing to calculate the reduct. Reduct means you have to take out the redundant values, right? So the solution is M of Q. So I had told you that time that if you, till then we had not discussed about the disability matrix. So one solution was the normal forms, right? But now we will be calculating this M. So this is the disability matrix. It is very, very necessary for you to see the previous lecture. Okay, it will be more understandability. So by the disability matrix of T, T is the table, okay? And M of T means the disability matrix of this table. We will mean N into N matrix defined as, now see here, M of IJ, that means we are calculating the member of, each member of that matrix. Okay, so C is the condition attribute set. So small c will be every member of the condition attributes. What is the condition attributes over here? Headache, muscle pain, and temperature. Whereas the decision attribute is flu. And this is the set of objects U1, U2, U3 up to U6. Right? So it should, the condition attribute of UI is not equal to condition attribute of UJ. Okay, then you have to also calculate the decision of UI and UJ. Then you try to add that in the your disability matrix in the different classes. For example, if you see here, this is different than this, right? And this is different. This entire set is different than this. So that is the meaning of this. Okay. So first we see that this is equal to this. Yes. But is this equal to this? No. That means this can be a subset, right? So this is how we calculate each and every cell of the disability matrix, where Mij is the set of all the condition attributes that classify objects UI and UJ into different classes. So obviously, this set is different than this set. Okay. And if you see that this is the entire reduct, which is different combinations of all the two conditional attributes. Same is the case with this type of reduct, having headache and temperature as conditional attributes. So what is disability matrix and disability function? Okay, why do you calculate this? It helps to construct efficient algorithms related to generation of minimal subsets of attributes. So this decision matrix will help us to calculate reducts actually. Okay, that's why I said it is preliminary. So initially we tried to calculate the member of that matrix and now the function. Okay, so function is the intersection, hai na, of all the union of the cells. Okay, where the union is the disjunction of all the variables such that, okay, the attribute is a member of Mij and Mij is not equal to null. Okay, so just with an example, now see this disjunction normal form. As I said, that one of the solution of when we had discussed about that issues in our decision tables, I told you that you can use the normalization forms. So if you have studied the disjunctive normalization forms, in that disability matrix and function calculation, and then using this type of function, you can DNF, you can use to define a reduct. Okay, so now this might be looking very complicated to you in terms of mathematics. Just that if it is false, then it is null, and if it is not null, then probably it is true. So we will see with an example, it will be more clear to you. In order to discern equivalence classes of the decision attribute T, to preserve conditions described by the decision discernibility matrix for this table. Now let's see U1, U2, U3, U4. There are three conditional attributes A, B, C and the decision attribute D. Okay. Now see, every decision table may not have a decision attribute, but for simplicity right now, condition attributes are A, B, C, decision attribute is D. Okay. Now A union C, intersection B, intersection C, intersection A union B, okay, is equal to B union C. How this we calculated? U1, U2, U3. And here U2, U3, U4. Okay, obviously here you will neglect the U4. Here you have neglected the U1. So if you consider here U1 and U2 combination, U1 and U2 combination, right? Now this is different. As we saw that it is different, then you have to put it here. So A, it is different. Then C, again C is also different. Okay, similarly U2 and U3. If you can see U2 and U3, this A1 and A0 are different. Okay, and even the B1 and B2 is different. Even C0 and C1 is different. Okay, so in this case, you will write B over here. Okay, and there is a gamma here. Why gamma? Because all U2, U3 are different. Whereas in terms of U1 and U3, okay, A is same, B is different, and C is same. That's why you have written only B. If all the three are different, then you write the gamma. Same you will see. Now, without seeing this table, you can see that U3 and U4, it's written gamma here because all the U3, U4 would be different. So you can cross-check here, see it is different, A0, A1, B2, B1, and C1, C1. Now here, C1, C1 is in terms of U2 and U4. But in terms of U3 and U4, it is same. So that is why this gamma, here U1 and U4. So here A and B you have written because C is same. Whereas in U1 and U4, if U1 and U4 you see A0, A1, B1 and B1, and C1 is C1. Now see U1 and U4, only A is different. So there is a mistake over here. Instead of this gamma here, you have to put A. Okay, this is just an example to tell you that this was a mistake. Okay, why this gamma should not be there? It would be A. Okay, so that is why I recommend that you write this information table in your notebook and recalculate it. Okay, so now after doing this, then A union C, right? Then you intersect with B, you intersect with C over here. Okay, then you intersect with A over here. This was a mistake, that is why. So what you have to do, this you have to do intersection and these combinations, union, you have to do over here, and all these you have to do the intersection. So when you calculate this, then you apply this formula, and when you use your normal association rules, then it will reduce to B intersection C. These six axiom rules, which you might have learned during your normalization, otherwise you go to our presentation on axiom rules and normalization. There are six axiom rules. Applying those six axiom rules, you will reduce this mathematical formula to this. So that is why, since now only two attributes, so instead of A, B, C, C conditional attributes, the indivisible attributes are B and C. That means A is a dispensable attribute. So reduct is B, C. Okay, so that is why we said to calculate a reduct, first you calculate the divisibility matrix, apply the function to calculate each MIJ, this formula, right? And then apply the divisibility function, and this is the divisibility function. So, and then after that, applying the six axiom rules, you reduce the reduct. Okay, so if you are not aware with the axiom rules, you can go through this slide. Okay, we have solved this using the distributive property, how it has been reduced to B intersection C. So this is another example of divisibility matrix, and the function calculated it is reduced to as follows. So you can again write this on your notebook, okay, and then applying the divisibility function and the six axiom rules, you try to calculate this as an homework. This is another example. Same thing over here. There are six attributes. Okay, so obviously here this U7 is discluded. Here the U1 is discluded, and then again the same formula MIJ is used to calculate this divisibility matrix. Okay, so out of them, if you see, you get two reducts, and then when you do the intersection of two reducts, you get B. So this becomes the core. As already said earlier, what is a core? Core is the intersection of all the reducts. That means this is the most important attribute of the entire information system. How we have done it? Again, we have explained here step by step. Okay, you can note these down just as a homework. How we reduced it to the two reducts. So basically, dependency of attribute, why we have done the calculation of reduct and core, because discovering dependencies between the attribute is an important issue in KDD. Now, if you remember the normalization, in normalization also you calculate the functional dependency. So if we say A implies B, what does this? It means that B is dependent on A. Okay, you remember functional dependencies of your normal DBMS normalization. So after you calculate the functional dependencies, then only you can convert your database into 2NF, 3NF probably. What is normalization? Normalization is to reduce the redundancy so that your complexity is reduced, but still maintaining consistency. That is the meaning of normalization. And when you perform normalization forms, the first step you do is finding out the functional dependencies. Now, in even machine learning, data mining, in your artificial intelligence, what was our key topic was the pattern extraction. So the basis of all these big terms is the pattern mining. You try to extract the pattern, okay, and then you fit it depending upon your data mining problem statement or your machine learning problem statement. For example, it's a predictive modeling approach, then probably you will fit it in rough set redux as a data mining framework. Okay, if it's a descriptive model approach, then probably you will fit the rough set reduct as a machine learning approach. So basically, pattern mining is the fundamentals over here. So for extracting the patterns, first you have to extract the dependencies. And that is why association rule we had discussed when we had discussed about the algorithms of data mining and machine learning. So association rules is nothing but finding the dependency between the attributes. Okay, so I think we will stop here. This lecture we would continue regarding the dependency, how to calculate the dependency in our next lecture with the revision of another example of whatever topics we have considered. Thank you very much for your patience listening. I hope this might be useful for your research, because I really consider that rough set theory is a very good mathematical tool to handle uncertainty. And the reduct technique of the rough set theory is another very big asset for feature reduction. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, you can put on the comment box, or you can mail me on aishabutalia@yahoo.co.in, okay? Or you can message me on the group. Thank you.